Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Above the Bar podcast, where each week we belly up to the bar with a new guest, find out what they do, who they are, and what makes them great. So sit back, relax, and enjoy. Alrighty, folks, it's your host, Sean. I know you're probably thinking, why do I have an extra episode this week? Why on a Saturday am I having to listen to this fool back at the bar doing what he does? Well, if you don't know, you know how much I love rye. And if somebody's going to tell me, hey, you can drink rye and new rye. And oh, by the way, and new bourbon. Oh, and you love movies and you can, these guys are into movies. And one of them made like, I don't know if we would call it a historical show, but it was like the first one ever. So I guess you could call it historical of some significance. I mean, I think it was on like Prodigy. Maybe. I don't know.
wasn't quite that far back.
It wasn't that far back.
But close.
It was on ColecoVision, I think. Today, we would say that's the name of an amazing Spanish TV channel, ColecoVision. So joining us, folks, all the way from Kentucky, which I mean that in and up Kentucky, right? You both are in Kentucky, right? No,
No, I'm in Los Angeles.
Worse.
And I'm in
LA.
Charlie's in Atlanta.
I'm in Atlanta. Yeah.
All right. So Charlie, we're gonna go ahead and kick Troy. Okay. I told you I love food. I'm gonna tell you. We're already fucking making left turns here. All right. I got Troy and Charlie from Filmland Spirits. Told you, Charlie, I have no idea how these intros are going to go.
Let's go.
Always
you got it, brother.
All right. Let's get some house cleaning done super fast. All right, folks, if you're joining us, maybe you're finding us through Troy and Charlie, through Filmland Spirits. Every week, we've got the big board over my right shoulder. If you're watching the live, that's for sticker and a cause. Maybe you've got your own liquor company. You've got your own thing you're supporting. You've got something that you're interested in. Reach out to me on Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, X, Twitch, Instagram, all those different platforms. They're all the Above the Bar podcast. Even our email is theabovethebarpodcast@gmail.com. Let me know what you got going on. I'll tell you where to send the sticker. Make sure I get a little write up on it, and I'll read about your stuff live on the air with the sticker and put it up there. I love the thumbs up. Is that you, Troy, doing that? Like,
nope.
Where is that thumbs up come from? I've never seen that before. Never seen that. It's popping up now. That's a new thing. But we have the big sticker and a cause. The next thing, though, is we got to talk about our sponsors. And I think Charlie could use our sponsors. And that's Budget Blinds of East Greenbush and Budget Blinds of Hudson. My man still got cords on looks like Bally's, either Lowe's or something. They're Bally's, aren't they? They're Bally's faux wood blinds, aren't they? They look like it. I can tell by the strings. Go ahead and call your local Budget Blinds. The one up here is of Hudson and Coxsackie, New York, and East Greenbush, New York. But if you listen, folks, we're getting ready to end the month right now. So they're going to be starting their new sale, their pre-Black Friday sale. It's called Triple 50. You give them a call, they're going to give you 50% off of one window, 50% off of installation, and 50% off of shipping as a pre-Black Friday sale. As long as you schedule your appointment between November 1st and November 24th, it's all covered. You're taken care of. It's Budget Blinds of Hudson, New York, and Hudson and Coxsackie, New York, and Budget Blinds of East Greenbush, New York. All right, it's all done.
I was in Hudson or East Green, I think it would be really clear who I'd be calling right now. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. But listen to me, Charlie. West Egg on a Sunday does pimento cheese grits. Have you had that yet?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, the next most important thing that you're in Atlanta.
All right.
Troy, I'm sorry you're in LA.
He comes out here, though, so he knows.
I come out to Atlanta a lot.
Have you taken him to a Chick-fil-A dwarf house yet?
Not a proper dwarf house, no. Not to
lie. Gotta take him to a dwarf house. I've told this story on the air many times. And I'll tell it again because it's one of my favorites. And then we'll talk about bourbon and everything. So I was sitting with one of my best friends, Terrell. We were working for CSX at the time. We were in training. And we're at the Chick-fil-A Dwarf House. And keep in mind, this is right across the street from our hotel, which Ric Flair stayed at our hotel the entire time we were there.
Nice.
And he kept it, like, for whatever reason, they let him park his Camaro out front in the circle. Nobody else's but his was always out front.
For whatever reason, because he's Ric Flair, come on.
Well, he wouldn't take, at first, like, I'm like, hey, will you take a picture of me? He's like, I don't take pictures in the bars anymore. I'm like, all right, well, that's cool, man. I just retired out of the Marine Corps and I was just hoping to get a picture. He's like, really? I was like, yeah. So he ended up taking a picture with me.
See, there you go. Like,
but we're in Chick-fil-A Dwarf House and me and Terrell, and the waitress looks at us and goes, y'all want to try something good? And I'm like, well, listen, you are a voluptuous woman and I'm not going to say no when it comes to food. So she goes and proceeds to explain to us to get the sweet potato souffle. Now, this is Chick-fil-A. Remember that, Troy. This is a sit-down restaurant, Chick-fil-A, that has sells burgers. She proceeds to tell us that we should get the sweet potato souffle with a scoop of ice cream on top of it. Do you want to know how glorious, warm sweet potatoes with marshmallow and scent brown sugar, and then throw a scoop of vanilla ice cream on top of that is? Like, that's a level that, like, is hard to explain.
It sounds like Thanksgiving at my house. You always have the sweet potatoes with the marshmallows and the brown sugar and ice cream on the side.
Oh, it's so glorious. Okay. So now I feel better. Hi, gents.
Now I'm hungry.
Okay. Now you're hungry, but a little bit of liquid lunch. Look at that. Just pull it all in. So Troy, you're as we just said a minute ago, you're in LA. Charlie, you're in Atlanta. Help me understand how we're making Kentucky bourbon then. I'm very confused now.
Sure. So while we live all over the country, we do all of our work in Kentucky. So our aging, our blending and bottling all happens in Kentucky. That's where our barrels are. It's where, our facility is that we do all the bottling at.
Okay. So now, Charlie, make sure I understood, but you're the master distiller, correct?
No, that would be a very kind term for me. Go ahead, Troy.
I was going to say, so we're what's, it's an industry term, but we're called what's called an NDP, which about 95% of the bourbon brands out there are NDPs, which means we are a non-distilling producer. So we source all of our whiskey from other distilleries.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So a lot of blends and stuff like that.
Yeah. So we'll source barrels and then we would do all the blending ourselves. So we've gotten pretty good at blending where we select exactly which barrels. We taste all of our barrels at least, every 6 months or at least every year. And then it's hard work. And then we come up with blends. And so we do that blending ourselves.
So you're not, because, I think most of us, like the modern, if you're really into bourbon, you watch the documentary Neat. Mm-hmm. And then it like just changes your life and you're like, all right, I've got to drink this stuff.
Yep.
Even after at one point in time, the girl goes, the first sip of bourbon tastes like gasoline. And you're like, then you try and you're like, yeah, she's right. Like this is. So you're not actually sitting there with a mash and going through the whole process of it. You're doing the other side to it, which I've heard that this is a big deal in that industry. There's so many people that kind of said, oh, I can make this, I can distill this. And then they have problems getting it to market.
Yeah. And that's exactly when we set out, we looked at, Charlie and I have been to almost probably over 80 distilleries all over the country at this point, started out for fun many, many years ago, and eventually became, research. And there was a common theme among many, many craft distilleries, which is they sunk a ton of capital into building an amazing facility and producing amazing liquid that they have to sit on for 2, 3, 4, 5 years before they can sell. And so they're trying to sell vodka and gin, which you don't have to age. And they put all their money into the distillery with not a lot left to sell and market the product. So they make amazing whiskey that nobody knows about. So we kind of looked at that and said, you know what? Let's reverse it. Let's do our brand. Let's still go find amazing whiskey that other people make, right, that we select because we have particular tastes that we like and we'll blend it to our taste, and let's focus on getting as many people as possible to enjoy our product and enjoy the branding that we bring along with it. Distillery, maybe one day down the road in the future, but we're really focused on the brand and bringing it to as many people as possible.
So that's kind of like that term, and I've heard it from some of the other distillers that we've had on here. What is it? Vodka is for money, bourbon is for love, or whiskey is for love. It's something along those lines, because you can produce it. You can just let me kick this right out. But the other stuff, you're years upon it. So that kind of, I'm going to get kind of in the weeds, and you know, I don't like to, but so is there, how do you maintain then? Like, if you know, you know, here you two are, and you're like, hey, I really like the notes from the above the bars bourbon, but it tastes way better when I mix it with Budget Blinds bourbon to create a thing. How do you maintain that going forward if one of them is like, hey, I've ran out because, you know, I had to go back to welding or some shit?
Right. So we have kind of two sets of products. We have our products that are like our core line that we will always have. So that's the Moonlight Mayhem Bourbon, Moonlight Mayhem Extended Cut, which is the cast strength version of that, Rise of the Robots Rye, and Rise of the Robots Extended Cut, which is the cast strength version of Rise of the Robots. Those we buy from a very large distillery that is not going to run out. And it's one that lots of people buy from. It's MGP in Indiana. So the liquid in those bottles all comes from there. We are sitting on a very large cache of barrels, and we have access to a lot more. Because of relationships that we've built up in the industry. So we're not worried about running out of that.
Gotcha.
Then we also have limited releases where we go and find very special short supply kind of bourbon or rye. And the first, we just put out our first limited release. We were at the Kentucky Bourbon Festival exhibiting this just in September, a month or so ago. And so our first one is called Town at the End of Tomorrow. The future wants its bourbon, and it's a Kentucky straight 9-year-old bourbon. Here, let's see. I've got a bottle of it right here.
Who does your labels? I got to ask, who does the labels?
So we create the concept first, right? We'll create like an original script for each one of the products that we want to come out with. And then we will create the poster for it. So we'll sit and, you know, come up, we've creative sessions, come up with a title first, sometimes a story idea. Sometimes we have a liquid that we found that we write a story for. And then I'll go into Photoshop and I'll sit and start mocking up, and I'll do like 30 or 40 mockups. Charlie will tell you, because like I'll start sending them to the team like in the middle of the night.
I'd say poor Charlie at 2 a.m, his phone's like,
oh yeah. Oh yeah. And then, you know, I'll get everybody's feedback, and we'll just go through a lot of iterations of that until we've got exactly what we want. And then we will bring in an artist, because I don't have the skill to paint
these beautiful
images, and the artist will recreate it from scratch, and we'll supervise them doing that. But, you know, and then typically Charlie and I work on the writing. A lot of times I'll, you know, do something and I'll send it over to him and I'll say, okay, now write all the copy for the bottle, because Charlie is a very creative writer, but he's also an excellent copywriter. So he does a really good job of coming up with all the stuff that's on the bottle.
So, all right. So, and that was kind of one of the things I wanted to ask you about, because folks, and look, if you're interested in what they got going on, make sure you go to anything where you just start follow Filmland Spirits, just like it sounds, and you can find them on anywhere on social media. But probably one of the most fascinating things, and I have a bottle, and I'm going to crack this open. I have not opened. I even made sure I had a clean, untainted glass, because I was drinking the Rye of the Robots for this one here. So, because I'm a Heaven's Hill guy, I like Heaven's Hill bourbon. So I figure that's my standard for bourbon.
Sure.
But I love the fact that you sit down and this has that very 50s drive-in movie vibe. And you know, like I'll read this one real quick here, folks, and then you know, you can listen to the smooth, silky sounds of my voice. Moonlight Mayhem. It's Romeo and Juliet with fangs in the story of two star-crossed lovers living in a modern world populated by werewolves. Can a human and his shape-shifting girlfriend protect their love from disapproving family and dangerous foes? Or will she be unable to resist sinking her teeth into the delicious snack that is her sweetheart? I mean, love that. Like, how do you not, How can you not read it that way? Also,
Troy was reading it along with you. I saw him like mouthing the words.
I mean, and then you got all the characters' name, and they got backstories, the QR code to go in further and get more onto it. And I love this because the first time I think I ever saw anything like this was Snoop Dogg's Death Row. Mm-hmm. And you can hold your phone. You got to download the app and you hold your phone over it, and it tells you about who these people were, which I thought was very interesting. But this is like a full-blown story. I did laugh when I realized the werewolf was running with a bottle of bourbon in his hand. I was like, nice. That's a great little add to it. But I guess the question is, you know, for the two of you, what was that conversation like? Who birthed this idea and who had to get talked into it?
So go ahead, Sean. You want to?
No, I'm pointing at you, like Hollywood.
I know you're the owner and founder there, but I want to know how this whole thing came to be.
So Charlie and I have been friends for about 30 years, and we've done businesses together. We've been screenwriting partners together over the years. But most importantly, just very good friends. And we both got into bourbon about 10 years ago or so, kind of separate. I always say separately and together. And we started meeting in Kentucky, the motherland, once a year at least, and going to distilleries. So we'd go to Kentucky for 4 or 5 days, go to like 5 or 6 distilleries a day, like crazy people. And we just fell in love with it. We fell in love with the culture and the art and the science and the cocktails and the people. And just one of those trips, we said, one day we got to do our own brand. But, you know, we're living, we both got kids, we're in separate parts of the country. So you flash forward a bunch of years, and I finally get to a place where I'm like, I'm doing this. I'm doing a brand, and I'm going to start working on it. And I'm sitting with another friend of mine who he's in the entertainment industry, but also happens to be a podcast host. And he's helping me get this all off the ground. And he starts, you know, interviewing me, just the two of us sitting there, and asking me what I'm passionate about. And I start talking about writing and the movies. And he says, you know, the passion you're talking about writing is the same passion you talk about whiskey and bourbon with. Find a way to combine those. And that was sort of that. Filmland Spirits, you know, came very quickly after that. Rise of the Robots came like out of my mouth seconds after that. Because we knew we wanted the labels to be bright and colorful. And so, right. And as soon as we started talking about combining passion of movies and bourbon together, it just, you know, I was like, this has got to be B movies. This is because B movies gives us this incredible canvas and this playground for fun and for bright, eye catching stuff. So then, you know, then I called up Charlie and I said, you know, we're doing this. We got to do this. And then, you know, from that point, then we start doing creative sessions where I didn't have to twist Charlie's arm, did I, Charlie?
I was about to say, Charlie, what was that conversation like when you heard, like, hey, we're going to do this? And you're like, what was that reaction like?
Wait, more bourbon? Okay. No, pretty much. Yeah. No, we'd been talking about it for years. So it was really just kind of bringing it from idea to reality. So I was 100% on board.
Now, the thing about Charlie is this Filmland Spirits wasn't the first concept we had. We had about 10 others before.
Well, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Right. And that's why we were just, my friend started interviewing me, because we were just like banging our heads against the wall to figure out what the right concept would be. Cause we'd come up with stuff we loved, and then either, you know, it was trademarked by somebody else, or it turned out there was a brand already out there like it. But Charlie has this unique talent. If you give him a creative, like we'd come up with a name, he can immediately project what a negative review would say. Right.
All right, like, so hold on, Charlie, the Above the Bar podcast.
No, I'm not doing it, dude. Nope. No.
If he wasn't being shy right now, he would say something like, Above the Bar should probably raise it a little bit. He has this knack. So we'd come up with an idea, and I'd call him, and I'd tell him the idea, and then he would immediately be like, oh, man, I can already see the headlines. If they don't like it, they're going to say this, this, and this. And I'm like, you're ruining it for, but
it, you ruined it. You ruined it.
It's great.
It's my horrible superpower. Yeah.
Because it pushed us until, you know, called up and said Filmland Spirits. And I remember Charlie was like, love it. Love it. That sounds great.
I love the name. Thank you. I was just over, you guys heard me at the end of the TikTok live I do before each episode. And one of the things that, you know, it might seem like silly and small, we were referring to the worst bourbon that I've ever had, that's to my left and shall not be named. Right. I don't care. You don't pay my bills. It's horrible. They're great marketing because they're in like a pretty important town if you're into sports. But what one of the things that was little that impressed me with you guys has nothing to do with what's in this bottle was the fact that you guys took the time that your bottles in the glass say Filmland. Like that might sound stupid to some people, but if you ever meet small batch distillers, one of the toughest things for them is finding bottles. So getting glass, getting bottles, especially through COVID was impossible. I know guys that were like, yeah, we were changing up everything we had just to get.
Yep.
And then for you guys to have like a legit bottle that says Filmland all over it, that's a pretty big deal in my opinion. Like, what did that even take?
That took a year of our lives.
Yeah.
It delayed launching the company for a year.
Really? Just to have these bottles?
We were planning on launching in fall of 21 and we ended up launching in September of 22 because the bottles took a year partially because of the shortages from COVID, and then all the factories that make the bottles are catching up and you had to wait in line. But the development on that bottle was over 7 months in terms of design and back and forth. And
I love it.
Yeah, it's meant. What's interesting is just because our labels are so sort of wild and crazy and colorful, we wanted to make sure that people understood we're serious about the whiskey. The packaging, we have fun with it and we don't take ourselves seriously. The liquid, we take ourselves seriously, right? And everything, for example, everything we've put on the market has won either gold or double gold at the San Francisco World Spirits Competition. Wow. So we are very serious about that. So we wanted the bottle to be a little more stately, a little more serious to say, hey, it's like when you go to the movies, right? You could go to an MGM movie or a Paramount movie. It could be a comedy. It could be a romance. It could be an action movie. But once you see that Paramount logo or that Universal logo, you know, it's a certain stamp of quality on it. So our bottle is like the proscenium for the liquid in the movie.
So what's funny is, and maybe this was part of it, was it reminded me of a marquee. Like the cap reminded me of a marquee, an older, not obviously an older marquee, but we're going to crack out. So if you were watching the live, folks, I just cracked the seal on the bourbon and I'll read this. Let me read this description. Who wrote these descriptions? Let me ask that. Who wrote the descriptions?
Charlie and I write those.
It was us. Yeah.
You write these? Delicious and sweet with cherry and citrus on the nose, vanilla and caramel on the tongue, and an intricate finish of toffee and toasted oak. Enjoyed neat on the rocks or in a cocktail, this smooth blend will delight werewolves and humankind. So, all right. So the bottle's open. I'm fucking...
Sean, I was watching when you like popped the plastic. Was if that wasn't a K bar, I'm like really disappointed, dude.
It was not a K bar. You know what? I'll tell you funny there. I only owned a K bar once in my entire Marine Corps career. And you used to be able to get them fairly on the cheap. They were like $25, $30. They were no big deal. Like guys just had them. And then like I went to go buy one not long ago. I was like, I should probably replace this. I haven't had one in a long time. They're like $90, $120. And I'm like, fucking stupid K bar. Like, it's not. And we don't even carry those in the Marine Corps anymore. We carry M9, like, bayonet knife things that, like, really kind of legitimately are better. But, all right, gents. So, as I'm pouring this, I got to ask this question. Since you've made this, what is your – do you have, like – I'm a neat guy. I started off on the rocks. And I found that I became a neat guy. Charlie, what are you?
I'm a neat guy. Yep.
How about you there, Troy?
Yeah, I'm a neat guy also. I mean, I enjoy cocktails, but if I'm going to taste a bourbon for the first time, I always taste it neat.
That's because you're in LA. I love Letterkenny, if you can't tell. Have you ever watched Letterkenny?
No.
I can't believe
you know, like soundboarded, dude.
You did. Like you've never watched. Man, it kind of hurts that you've never. You don't need to, especially as a TV guy. You got to watch Letterkenny. It's like a Canadian-based show.
Okay.
And it's absolutely hilarious. It's on Hulu. A lot. You know how all of a sudden you started hearing that sound effect and it sounded like everybody was doing like the porn star moan. You know what I'm talking about? It got real annoying. Letterkenny.
Okay.
Like they do a whole bar scene where they're like talking about how porn stars sound and they're like making the noise. Each one of them had like their opinion of what a porn star sounded like. So, but all right, gents, enough about porn stars. Let's drink your bourbon.
Let's do it.
All right. So smells good.
So this one is Moonlight Mayhem, a saga of werewolves and bourbon. It's a 94 proof. This one won a double gold at San Francisco.
Now, you know what I got right away off of that was that toffee toasted taste. Like right away, like for me, it went right to that. That could be because I had the bourbon or the rye already a little bit, but that's instantly. Wow. And almost like a vanilla flavor to it. Like, wow. Yeah.
We try not, you know, we have tasting notes on the bottle because we want it to be accessible to everybody. But when we're sitting with tasting with people who know what they're doing, we don't like to lead the witness. So yeah, I'm not going to tell you what to expect to taste. I want to hear what you taste out of it.
Yeah, like so for me, you know, obviously I read the cherry. I can taste a little bit of that, but more so what I get out of that, I should have had water with me to clean my palate. But I get more of that vanilla. And this might sound crazy to people. When I smell bourbon, I need that first smell. As we were joking about the gasoline smell. I need to have a gasoline kind of a smell. It needs to smell like liquor. Does that make sense? Like alcohol?
Sure.
Like I don't want it to be like I'm sniffing something and it like where people are like, I don't really smell anything.
Well, then Yeah, no, you want it to
be something there.
Right.
And I do the air suck thing. Like, I don't suck, folks. I just the air thing. But gents, that's two for two, and that's not because you're just on my show. I would tell you if I was like, man, it's okay. It's pretty good. I have no problem. I didn't tell you guys the rules about the show beforehand. There's three rules. Nothing's off topic. Everybody's welcome. There's only gets to be one asshole, and that's me. So
I have to hang up now. Sorry.
Time to go. Sorry. But yeah, absolutely. Wow. That is really so you're but now this is still considered as a blend, though. I think the blend thing for me is like I've learned more about it from having friends that are in the industry and learning more about it. But the blend piece to this, like, I know you said you sat and you drink all these different barrels and bottles and whatnot, but how difficult is it to finally like go, all right, two parts this, one part that, or whatever the process is?
That's why we always say, and I think everybody from distillers to blenders or whatever will say it is both an art and a science, right? Because when you're people always ask that, like, how do you come up with these ideas? And I'm like, I don't know. They just come and I'm in a certain mood or I get motivated or you go into it. Like when I write, sometimes I just kind of go into a trance and I don't really, you know, it just kind of all comes out. And then I look at it and go, oh, that's interesting. I think the blending is, there's a little more science to it than that. But I think the blending, as I think about it, because I've asked myself that same question, like how do we end up here? So not to get too technical, but we are not considered, by law, a blend. We are a straight bourbon. A blend would be if we're taking different barrels of bourbon made in different places or with different recipes and blending them together. All the barrels that go into our bottle are the same bourbon. They're made in the same place. They're made with the same mash bill. They may be different ages, right? But they all are the same, you know. So we're blending together those barrels, but there is a massive difference from barrel to barrel. We can open up one barrel, taste it, and be like, what the heck is this? And open another and go, we're saving this for a single barrel because it's the greatest thing I've ever tasted because maybe it's a different lot. Maybe it was aged in a different part of the warehouse. We also bring our barrels to Kentucky and age them, so that changes them over time as well.
All right. Two questions. We're going to start with the first one. You mentioned cask strength.
Sure.
This is a very hot topic in the world of bourbons and liquors and whiskeys, where a lot of these companies are coming out with this term cask strength and saying, hey, come drink this. It's way stronger. It's cask strength.
Right.
What made you want to go that way? And tell me your viewpoint on saying that, yup, cask strength is legitimately of higher strength than, you know, as you said, buying our regular bourbon or there. What's different? Because I kind of look at cask strength and I go, I'll be honest. I'm like, sure. So help me out here.
Sure. So we've got two products. What you just tasted is our Moonlight Mayhem. That is not cask strength. That we proof down, which means we add water to it to bring it down to, you know, 47% alcohol, 94 proof. And we do that very specifically because when we blended that Moonlight, and this answers a little bit of your other question, which I don't even think I answered, but when we blended that, we said, let's make a bourbon that we like, but let's make it really accessible because we know our labels are probably going to attract some new bourbon drinkers and we want them to enjoy their first experience with bourbon, not have it hit them too hard, have some sweetness in there, that kind of thing.
Peanut butter. We lost Troy just like that for me saying peanut butter.
Yeah, he got
how to fuck him. Troy. Yeah. I said peanut butter and we lost Troy. I just took another sip and that's what I tasted.
Oh, okay. I think I cut out there for a second. I lost you guys.
I took another sip and I'm sorry. I had to throw that out there. I tasted peanut butter.
You tasted peanut butter. Okay.
Does that make any sense? Or I haven't had that much to drink. I promise.
You taste whatever you taste. It's subjective. A large portion of it is subjective.
I tasted peanut butter. Right. All right, go ahead. So you pair it down with a little bit of water to bring it to a new strength.
Right. And that's, we wanted to make that bourbon really accessible to new bourbon drinkers, but complex enough and flavorful enough for, you know, seasoned bourbon drinkers as well. Then we said, let's make a cask strength for us, the kind of bourbon that we love to drink. And so what happens is cask strength means we're bottling it at whatever proof it came out of the barrel at.
Okay.
Right. There's no water added to it. There's nothing done to it. It's just whatever that proof is, that's what it goes in. So it's going to be higher. So our Moonlight Mayhem is 94 proof. The current batch of cask strength is 114 proof. Right. But we're also all about a cask strength that's smoother and is not, you know, most people, when they try our cask strength bourbon, they go, that doesn't drink like it's, you know, that high a proof. We want to make sure that
paint off the wall.
Right, exactly. But the whole idea of cask strength is there's more alcohol in it, and the flavor is not coming from the water, right, that you add to alcohol. The flavor is coming from the alcohol. So when it's higher strength, you're going to have more flavor. There's more complexity. There's more things going on. So as you evolve as a whiskey drinker, if you're able to, you know, if you're comfortable having higher alcohol, you know, and learning to not feel that burn or, you know, or find alcohol that doesn't have a burn, you're going to get a lot more flavor out of it.
100% agree with that. That is such a, well, that's, you know, that's that initial burn taste and then moving on.
Right.
So, and folks, Charlie deserves a round of applause because Charlie's manning up. He sent me a message earlier. He was feeling a little under the weather and he's still hanging with me. So brother, I appreciate you. If you still, you know, you still feeling up to it, but so is there anything on the horizon as far as bourbons, whiskeys? Like I'm a big fan of White Dogs. I think that is a unsung liquor that, you know, and it's not a flavor for everybody. It is like when people drink sour beer, please dump your sour piss water out. I don't like it. I made that mistake of tasting Ithaca Brewery's sour. And some people are like, it's amazing. And I'm like, this is gross. This is absolutely disgusting. But is there anything on the horizon where you're like, hey, we really want to get into this?
Charlie, you up to answering?
Yeah. Well, I'll do my best, as punchy as I am. As Sean said, I'm not feeling the greatest, but so, I mean, specific to like White Dog, we've like right now, all of the whiskey that we own is aged, to some degree. We have been, exploring sourcing new make whiskey. Although we don't necessarily currently have any new make whiskey, but it's one of the things that we're definitely looking at. But yeah, on the horizon, we have a number of things kind of we have an ongoing innovation pipeline that is, you know, like Troy said earlier, we have our kind of our core products, and then we have a number of products that we experiment along the way. The most recent being Town at the End of Tomorrow, which is our 9 year. You're laughing. Did I say it wrong?
No, I was laughing because what is it? Town at the End of Tomorrow that wants their bourbon back or something like
that. Exactly.
The future wants its bourbon. Yeah.
Future wants its bourbon. Yeah. But we will continue to do innovative products going forward. We have some stuff that's been sitting in barrels for almost like 2 years now. I feel like it's been quite a while. So we have some product that's really unique, unlike anything anybody else has. I feel like that's been sitting in barrels for at least a year, some of it a year and a half. We'll do some finishes, and then, you know, you mentioned new make. We'll get there eventually. Although our intent is to release more aged product. I don't know if we have anything like Troy. We haven't talked about anything younger per se in the immediate future.
No, everything that goes into our bottles will always be at least 4 years old. If it's an aged whiskey, it'll always be at least 4 years old. What you're drinking there is about 5.5 years old.
Yeah.
I didn't look. Do you batch number these?
We don't anymore. Depends on when you got that bottle.
Yeah.
We did in the beginning. In the beginning, we had batch number, batch name, everything.
So those are collector's editions.
They are because
now they are. Yeah.
Logistically, it is just too challenging, to be honest. And it created too much, made it too hard to get the product out the door. Because our labels don't have any handwriting on them, nothing's handwritten, we can't add special numbering after the fact. God. So you have to figure out how much yield are we going to get out of this batch? Let's not print too many labels and have to throw them out. Let's not print too few. And it just became too much. So we decided after the first batch to take that stuff off. And you know, we know it because we there's things about it that we know separate batch to batch. But for now, until we are much bigger and we're on big giant machines that can print after the fact, we won't have batch numbers on there.
I'll tell you another one. I got to introduce you to a buddy of mine, Doug Smythe, from Phoenix Shaving. This is going to sound crazy, but his Phoenix Shaving stuff does the exact similar theme of that 50s B movies, but for shaving with old school, drop the razor in, tighten everything up, that kind of stuff. Have you looked at, you know, even partnering? And I'm not saying like, hey Doug, come find us, we'll partner. I just need 1% of whatever happens if you guys do, because you could make a bourbon aftershave. I love it. I'm on this shit. But have you looked at, you know, because of the movie themes and some of the things that are out there, or is that, you know, kind of going to your guys' background a little bit here, is that even a thing you could do to partner with somebody to be like, hey, we're partnering this? Because we've seen some bourbons out there that, you know, in whiskeys, obviously proper 12. God, I saw somebody else who, you know, I mentioned the Snoop Dogg thing. There was another one the other day that I saw. I was like, everybody's like, oh, such and such actor has a bourbon now. And then I read on it and I'm like, they just put some money into it. They didn't do shit. Like, let's not call it their bourbon. You know, it's like George Clooney's vodka. Everybody's like, look, it's George's. Trust me, George at no point in time was mashing potatoes up to make vodka. But is there anything like you like, hey, I really want to work with these guys or those guys?
You know, you kind of answered the question, which we specifically, because we got asked that all the time, especially in the beginning when we were fundraising and doing everything. People are like, oh, you should get a celebrity involved. And we're like, you know what? That's not what we're doing. If we get a celebrity involved, I think it takes what we're doing and cheapens it a little bit, where, you know, what we're doing is creative. It's coming from us. It is our creativity. It is our passion, and the story and the liquid are so tied together. It's not, you know, it's not this thing that we just slapped on. There's, you know, tremendous amount of thought and detail that goes into it. Now, if somebody who happened to be famous became a huge fan of us and they were creative and they got in touch and said, I would love to do a collaboration with you, you know, sure, we're always open to that kind of conversation, but we're definitely not like a celebrity brand in that regard.
You're not whoring for it right now. You're like, if somebody shows up at the door and it's raining outside, you know, you're going to give it to damn it, Janet, you know, you're not whoring for one of them to show up. And I get that. Is there any of those, like, you remember, I don't know if you guys had, where'd you guys grow up at? Was it like LA and Atlanta you grew up in?
No, I grew up in New York.
Oh, that's right. You're from Brooklyn.
I was born in Brooklyn. Yeah.
Yeah. From Crooklyn. You know, I'm from Baltimore. You guys like, how about you, Charlie?
I'm an Army brat. So I grew up all over.
Fort Lost in the Woods. Did you ever end up there? Fort Leonard Wood, Fort Lost in the Woods.
A couple of times, actually. My dad was field artillery, so yeah, we lived there a couple of times. Yeah.
Well, you can tell your dad I said this. The best officers that I had in my 20 years in the Marine Corps were always artillery officers.
There you go.
By far, never, like, our infantry officers, if I had to deal with an infantry officer, they were like a 50-50 shot that they were like really good or really trying to get promoted. Anybody else who was like a suppo supply officer, sucked. Oh, absolutely boy. Sucked. Absolute goat nuts. They are the worst humans on the planet. They couldn't.
Hey, Charlie, what did you do when you were a captain in the Army?
Were you a suppo? You weren't a suppo. I wasn't in the Army.
What are you talking about, Troy?
Charlie, you weren't a suppo, were you?
Charlie, no, I don't know what you guys are talking about.
Charlie, God, please tell me you weren't a suppo. I really liked you. My worst CO ever was a suppo.
In the Army, we called it quartermaster, not suppo.
That's not a suppo. Something else. I'm telling you that I'm calling him a suppo. That's listen to me. But tell your dad.
All right, I'll tell him. He'll be very happy, actually.
Artillery officers were by far the best leaders I ever dealt with in the Marine Corps, by far. And I used to go to, and I've gone, I was in an artillery unit for my first 4 years. So, but completely left turn here, folks. But is there,
yes, Natalie Portman, call us stat because like we're ready.
I got a plan for us. Are you guys ready? I got a plan where you're going to get a celebrity to endorse your stuff. You ready? Mm-hmm. But it's going to take like a weekend trip for you. You're going to have to travel on Thursday and then you can leave either Sunday afternoon or Monday morning. But here's what you're going to do. You ready?
Yeah.
You're going to get, you know, you're going to get some Moonlight Mayhem. You're going to get some Rye of the Robots and you're going to put them up and you're going to go to Hudson, New York.
All right.
Troy's shaking his head. He already knows where I'm going with this.
I don't, but I've spent, you know, I dated a girl for years from Peekskill.
Okay, that's further south. We're north.
North, okay.
You're going to go to Hudson, New York. I was an Amtrak conductor for 7 years.
Nice.
I dropped off Sarah. I picked up Sarah Paulson there. We've had Drew Barrymore get on there. We've had, what the heck's his name? Billionaires, the show Billionaires, the redheaded guy. Gotta can't think of his name right now. Dylan, or God, I can't think of his name from the show Billionaires, but he's like the main character in Billionaires. But all the celebrities take the train and they get on Fridays and they come up to Hudson and they leave on the noon train out of Hudson to go back to New York City.
Mm-hmm.
So you could sit there in Hudson, old school fruit stand style, and start passing out, and they would see the name and you could just pass out stuff. Cause just south of us in Rhinecliff, that's where Paul Rudd and Negan, I can't think of his name right now, Jeffrey Dean Morgan, own the candy store in Rhinecliff, New York.
Okay.
So you come here, let me know, I'll carry bottles for you. If one shows up missing, I can't help you.
Right.
It happens. Loss prevention, call somebody and we can do that. What do you think? Sound like an idea?
Sure. I guess we're taking an Amtrak ride in upstate New York.
And I need Frankie B's. I think that's what the name of it was, the barbecue place down in Atlanta. I need that one. It's like Frankie's or Freddy's or something like that. All I know is it was the best Frito pie I've ever had.
Best Frito pie. Oh, now I have to look into that.
Yeah, it's like pretty impressive Frito pie. I have to look through my notes on my phone, but yeah, it's a Frankie B's or Freddie B's or Frankie's barbecue or some shit. I don't know. You guys have amazing food in Atlanta. That's all I can tell you. Is like I ate like such a king in Atlanta. Like I loved the food there. But nonetheless, moving on, as I sit here and ramble on to myself. We're getting ready to close up the bar. We got to get some more things in. What about cocktails with this stuff? I mean, I know we're talking about mixers and everything, but I did want to know, like, most people, we're absolute lunatics because we're drinking all this neat and that's what we enjoy. But I think most people, that is not their go-to with any of this stuff. They're looking for the mixer. So for you guys, what has been your go-to mixer? Or how do you find, or have you even created like, hey, this is our signature cocktail or anything?
Yeah, sure. So on our website, we got a lot of content on our website. You know, we have like, if you scan the QR codes, QR code on every bottle, you'll get to the website, and we have storyboards for the movie. We have script pages. We have a trailer you can watch for the movie. We have movie poster you can download, all of that. But we have an entire cocktail section as well. And in that cocktail section, it's basically our take on some pretty, you know, traditional cocktails, just, you know, twisted a little bit and using our products. So we have like a Hollywood Boulevard DA, because Moonlight Mayhem takes place on Hollywood Boulevard. And we have a robot smash instead of a whiskey smash, you know, made with a Rise of the Robots, and, you know, slight changes in the ingredients and that kind of thing. But Charlie and I are both, I mean, old fashions are a go-to for us. You know, in Manhattan's. What's that?
I don't think I've ever had an old fashioned.
Really?
Yeah. You know,
now we definitely have to take that train ride, because we'll make you some
old. Definitely. Fun. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I don't know. I've never been here. I'll let you look behind the curtain. If you ever hear the words tequila sunrise come out of my mouth, put me in the cab, the Uber, get me out of the room. The blackout is coming. It's normally the last thing I remember is the words tequila sunrise. And then I wake up and I'm like, where am I?
What did I do?
What's going on? That is the, that has become like the final, and it's, folks, if you never had one, it's just nothing but sweetness, sugary, grenadine, orange juice, and tequila. Just
so that was what I was going to say is there's a lot of old fashions out there that are overly sweetened.
Yep.
And okay. Charlie and I are not a fan of that. I want an old fashioned where I can taste the whiskey, where I can taste the bourbon.
It's a classic bartender test, actually, is like order an old fashioned and you'll see if the bartender knows what's what.
Right. Okay, so that should be like your go-to, like order an old fashioned. But now where do you go then though to create your baseline? Like, do you have any recommendations? Like, there's so many of these places now, like especially, you know, if you go down into the city, and there's only one in the city, folks, it's New York City. You know, if you're in Baltimore, we call it going into town. New York City, you call it going to the city. Mm-hmm. But is there any, like, there's a lot of those pop up now, like where like the hipsters have taken over and they're like, I'll mix you anything you want. But where do you go and find like a good one so you can create a baseline? What do you think?
Oh my gosh. I'm totally drawing a blank now. There's a bar on like the Upper East Side around 76th or so. And I am totally
you sent me there. I'm like blanking on the name of the place.
I've sent Charlie there.
I know.
They make a fantastic old fashioned. And
let's Google that. Nate. All right, Nate just showed up. All right, so Nate, I need you to do some Googling. What is it now?
It's on the Upper East Side. And I haven't been there since before COVID, so I don't know if it's
survived. So who knows COVID. If it's even open or not. Upper East Side.
Around 76th or 79th somewhere and like first. Oh my gosh, I cannot remember the name of it. And I send people there all the time. And every time I go to New York City, if I can get there, I go there. They make a fantastic old fashioned.
All right, here we go. You ready?
Yeah.
We got the East Wing. We have the Pony Bar, Jones Wood Foundry, second floor bar in Easton, the Stumble Inn, the Sefton, Horns Hook Tavern, Phil's Hughes Bar.
You gonna hit Watson. It? What?
Doc Watson?
No.
Bondurance.
Yes.
Yeah. Bondurance. Bondurance.
Bondurance. That's it. Oh, yeah. Look at that.
Isn't that it, Troy?
It sounds like it. Yeah.
303 East 85th Street, this says.
That might be
That's right. It, Bondurance?
Yeah.
Rustic bar with whiskey and rotating beers.
I feel like that's it.
That's it.
Here, let me get a picture. Let me see if I can get one of these pictures to come up. Does that look like the bar? Does that look familiar?
That's it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, yep, that's it.
Well, there you go. So we'll all so
thank you.
Listen, folks, shameless plug. Bondurance. Oh God, I can't read. I'm so fucking illiterate.
I was gonna say it's got like a French name, I thought. So there's
So wait, I have an off-the-cuff place though. Like also makes a great old fashioned, but it is like right off of Times Square. So if you're trying to avoid that place, avoid it. But if you go down near Times Square, the Rum House, they do a great rum old fashioned, but they have a really good whiskey selection as well and make a great whiskey old fashioned as well. The Rum House, R-H-U-M, Rum House.
I'm a, I'm a Hell's Kitchen guy. I'm a Hell's Kitchen
guy. Not far. It's a, not that far.
Not far at all. Not
far at all.
God, I wish I could remember the name of the place we just found. My best friend Ken and I, we went to New York City Comic Con. I go every year.
Yeah.
And we found a place, shameless plug. We walk into the bar and I'm sitting there going, I know that guy. I can't think of his name. I know that guy. It's Joe Jusco. And if you're in the comic books, he's an artist. He's amazing.
Yeah.
Joe Jusco's sitting right there with his wife. And I'm like, and the next day we're going around and I'm like, Joe, I saw you at the bar yesterday because I saw a sign. And I was like, fuck, it's Joe Jusco was at the bar. Yeah. And that place was awesome. They say, Nate says, was going to Google the best version of the drink in that area and see what comes up. Well, Google it, Nate, and tell me what comes up.
There we go.
So I've actually done a bunch of years ago. I was supposed to have plans with a friend. I was in New York City and his wife was pregnant. He was like, I can't come out. The baby could come every any minute. So I'm like, well, now I'm on my own. All right. So I did a walking old fashioned tour of the Upper East Side. And I started at Bondurance and had an old fashioned there as my baseline because I'd been there before and I knew I loved it. And I just stopped at as many restaurants and bars as I could all up and down the East Side and the Upper East Side and had, I probably, you know, tasted, I couldn't sit there and drink them all, but I tasted probably 10 different old fashions that night. And they were all decent, but I walked away with a very important lesson. And I'm a huge fan of Mexican food. Do not order an old fashioned at a Mexican restaurant. that is a, you know, you're not getting the best old fashioned when it's overly sweet and it's filled with like crushed ice, like you get at the soda machine, right? It's just filled to the top with crushed ice and there's like a lot of fruit in it, you know, and that kind of thing. It's like, yeah, not going to be the best old fashioned. Charlie and I have even had old fashions at a Mexican restaurant in Kentucky. Not great.
not just once, but many times actually. I feel like, yeah,
a couple of times at least.
Senor, you need the old fashioned, senor. We got you.
Yeah.
Don't worry about
when
it.
When it comes in, it's like a fruit salad. I mean, I guess you can write it off as like this is healthy or something. But
I'm doing something good for my body at this point.
Exactly.
That's amazing. But you know what? You know, completely sidebar as we're getting closer to the end here. I will tell you, I've been to a lot of bars in a lot of places. The worst is Philly, because Philly is like you start off on Delaware Ave and everybody's like, hey, I really like this bar. And you have to physically drive like across town to get to this other bar. And you're like, I'm going to get a DUI at any minute here. Like, there's no reason for this. Baltimore, we're good. Like Fells Point. If you've never been to Fells Point, there's like a million bars every other corner. It's amazing. But I have to say, New York City bar scene, I've partied in Barcelona. I've been to Toulon. You know what? I'll tell you the two of them. Venice, Italy, and New York City have two of the best bar scenes. Completely different scenes, but two of the best bar scenes I've ever been to. There's nothing like you can just find a bar, and everybody in New York City. I've never gone to a New York City bar where somebody was douchey to me.
Yeah,
does that make sense? Like,
yeah,
everybody's like, nobody's from here. Nobody started off here. So just come on in. Like, you must have just moved here. Just sit down. Fuck it. Come on.
Right.
All right.
Wait, the bar scene. I mean, the bourbon bar scene in Kentucky is great, you know, especially in like downtown Louisville. There's a great places to drink there.
Yeah. The only thing I would add is like after, and Troy mentioned earlier, when we do blending, we'll taste 20, 30 barrels worth of, you know, like worth of samples. And then at the end of the day, I'm like, dude, I just want a martini. I need a break from
vodka. Like completely flavor profile.
Yeah, I need a break from bourbon. I have yet to get, and like, God bless, I love Kentucky more than any state in America probably, but I cannot get a good martini in that state to save my life. And I have tried many, many times.
You get called a sissy boy when you order a martini, don't you? That shit now. Again, hey, sissy boy, you want a martini? What the hell you need that for, sissy?
Right. You go back to the old fashioned. It's like, all right, fuck it. I meant an old fashioned. I'm right. Sorry.
But the thing is, there's like downtown Louisville and downtown Lexington, there are world-class restaurants. I mean, the food scene in Kentucky and those parts of Kentucky is fantastic. You know, world-renowned chefs have places there. And still the martinis tend to fall short. The bourbon drinks are fantastic, right? But the martinis tend to be like, why does this taste like cleaning fluid?
So. Well, I would think that like in Kentucky, like bourbon-wise, it's got to be like a Philly with a cheesesteak. It's really like, who do you know? It's what neighborhood are you in? Yeah. Like nobody's drinking the typical names we all know around the country. Like I mentioned Heaven's Hill earlier.
Right.
FYI, folks, they own like, hey, if you really like that Buffalo Trace, it's fucking Heaven's Hills. They own Buffalo Trace, FYI.
You know what the difference is? There are so many brands and people do drink their go-to, but there's a lot of bourbon tourists. There's 2 million tourists come into Kentucky every year for just bourbon. Yeah, and so there's a lot of people coming. They're looking for something special, but they're also bringing people with them who are new to bourbon, and so they are trying, you know, and believe me, I'm a fan of, and I know Charlie is too. We love like Woodford Reserve, and they're a product we love, and you know, and Sazerac products like Buffalo Trace and everything. We love those too.
My grandmother, old granddad.
Yeah, man.
And I will tell you right now, if you've never had a glass of old granddad, as long as you don't show somebody the label, it's a good fucking bourbon.
You're talking about the regular or the 114?
No, high proof.
The 114.
Like the legit granddad.
Old granddad 114 is
like put hair on your put hair on the bottom of your feet.
Yeah.
Old granddad.
Oh, yeah. Good stuff.
Yeah. That was what my grandmother drank. Like, and we're talking
your grandmother and my granddad would have like gotten along.
My grandmother's nickname was G.I. Judy. She never served a day in her life, but she would come into rooms and like bark orders at everyone. And Nate just threw out a great bar in Baltimore. The Horse You Came In On bar is the one that they say is the location where Edgar Allan Poe died. Like that was the last bar he drank in and then died when he came out.
Right. Fell into a puddle or whatever.
There's like, we just did a thing here at the Egg in Albany where it was a Edgar Allan Poe speakeasy. So as the show went along, they read from famous poems and then provided a cocktail based on that poem. It was really, really neat.
Very cool.
But all right, Nate, you didn't ask it. So now I feel like I'm full of shit here. You didn't ask these guys what their go-to is. So what I'll ask it for Nate, because Nate normally asks it. What is your go-to, like having a bourbon or having a mixed drink, go-to like bar food, meal, anything?
Well, okay, because you know, I if it's late night and we're in Kentucky,
I know where you're going.
We're gonna stop somewhere and get some soft pretzels and beer cheese.
Okay, Kentucky, I like beer cheese.
That's a late night Kentucky thing. But we've had, I mean, there's a restaurant in Kentucky. What is it called? Agave and Rye. It is an upscale Mexican place. They serve pretty much just all really fancy tacos and all kinds of rye whiskey. There's a couple of locations. There's one in Lexington and one in Louisville. Fantastic. Love doing that. And then I'm also like, I love, like, if I'm just sipping bourbon, I'm not having a whole meal. I love bourbon with nuts and bourbon with like green apples and peanut butter. Like just great snacks to have with. Yeah. They enhance the flavor of each other. Try it.
I'll have to try that one.
If it's after dinner, dark chocolate. Yeah, go ahead, Troy.
No, all those, I agree. Troy will tell you that when we've done blending and we go back to the hotel after like having drunk whiskey all day long, I'll go through the hotel and steal all the bags of popcorn that I can, microwave popcorn that I can possibly find. So microwave popcorn and
salty, buttery.
Oh yeah. Sketchy, like microwave popcorn, hotel microwave popcorn. And then he said it, but I can't emphasize enough the beer cheese in Kentucky. We've had clients and partners that have gifted Troy beer cheese to have with his drinks with at night.
That is a beautiful. Nate wants to know about pizza. Yay, nay.
Oh, yeah. Now you're making us feel bad because the longer the night goes on, after we've had the beer cheese and the popcorn and whatever meal and the tacos, like 2 a.m. pizza. Yeah, pizza, for sure. Yes.
You know who's got two spots that I will tell you that have the best pizza, that like late night pizza? One is Larisi's in Philly. You know it, you just don't realize you know it. Okay. You know the song Summertime by Will Smith?
Yeah.
He talks about Larisi's in that song. He talks about chilling outside of Larisi's.
Really?
And when you go into Larisi's, they have signs all the way around it that says, do not ask for toppings. We don't have toppings. Don't bother us about toppings. Like every 6 feet or 6 inches, it's like a sign. And all it is, and DC does the same thing. These giant slices of straight up cheese pizza. Like just cheese. You can see the sauce through the cheese. Roll that sucker up and go. That's, gents.
Now I really am hungry.
Wait, so that was what you said. There was another one. What was the other one?
DC, like go down to DC, anywhere around DC. They call them DC giant slices. When you go down to DC, that's like a big thing down there, is these big slices. But you actually, Charlie, you do understand, and I mean this, you have, in my opinion, the number one pizza place in the country.
So I'm curious where you're about to go with this.
Let's go.
So Antico just got, it didn't get a Michelin star, but it got a Michelin mention for the first time ever. Atlanta got Michelin mentions. There were a number of restaurants that got one star mentions, but Antica got a, like, whatever the category is, like restaurants you have to try from Michelin. So 1,000,000% agree. Troy's been. We've been.
Oh, yeah. We've eaten there a whole bunch of times. There's one at the Battery where the Braves play.
There is, yeah.
So the only one I've ever been to is in this, like, little Italian three-store district.
Yeah.
And it was – I had the rudest people that ever took my money at the counter. And then you walk through this door that's like Mary Poppins' bag because you're like, there's no seating. Oh, shit. And you walk through and their bacon pizza, absolutely unbelievable. And I love it when people are like, Atlanta doesn't have good pizza. And then I'm like, I pull up the Travelocity top 10 pizza places in the country, and Antico and Atlanta's in there.
Yeah. Antico's dope. It's really good pizza. I agree.
So gents, we could talk pizza and bourbon. I even went my time. Like, you guys are so much fun to talk to.
Thank you. So are you.
Folks, listen, give them a follow at Filmland Spirits. See what they've got going on. Start following them. I forgot the code. God, I almost. The code. Look, if you want to try this, is it Boo10?
Right. So you go to filmlandspirits.com and you can order all of our products. We ship to 43 states. And the right now through Halloween, there's a discount code Boo10, BOO10, and you get 10% off everything except our limited release.
So look, folks, Boo10, BOO10, get yourself a bottle, get yourself set up. I'm going to tell you, it's a tough call, but I'm going to go with the rye. I'm going to tell you of the two, but I'm a rye guy. It's just
right.
I'm a rye guy, but the Moonlight Mayhem. When I hit that peanut butter note is important to me in those. I always get that, but Man, that rye is absolutely on point. So make sure you look, folks, if you're finding us through Filmland or Filmland through us, make sure you're going on to all these social media locations. You're taking the time. It might sound cliche. It might sound bullshit where we're like, hey, give us a like, follow, and share. Take the time and do those things. It actually matters to us. It actually makes a difference for us doing those things. That's how these guys get found. That's how these guys get pushed. That's how I get pushed. More listeners, more people understanding what we've got going on. So make sure you take the time and you listen to all of us. My wife just got back from, she just had a food tasting. I paid for it. We were at the Arthritis Foundation here locally in Albany, and they had a silent auction, and I won the silent auction for this Spanish food, all Spanish food based on some architect that like they've like based the food on some Spanish architect. And I'm like, this is going to be great. And then I went, shit, it's on the 28th from 6 to 8. I'm like, well, I guess I know what I'm not doing. I'm going to drink whiskey and bourbon. Damn, son of a bitch. So my wife just got back from that. So she's back here trying to like hold bottles up and whatnot.
But bring you some takeout at least, or
no takeout. What did I have? I don't even remember what I made for dinner. Oh, we had, this is how bad subs are here in Albany. Do you know what the best sub spot in Albany is? Jersey Mike's.
Oh, well,
yeah. Yeah. Jersey
Mike's. Yeah. So, but make sure folks, you give them a like, fair, follow, share, all those kind of things. We went over a little bit on our normal time, but absolutely amazing story of what you guys got going on. Don't log off on me afterwards. I do have to talk to you for just a half a heartbeat. But before we finish, and you guys can Rochambeau for this, as we do, and like I said, you guys listen to all 200 and some episodes. So I know you know what's coming up here. Every time, the guest always gets the final word. So whoever wants to go first, what is your final word, Troy?
Well, first of all, thank you for having us. We appreciate it very much. We had a great time, a lot of fun. Sorry, Charlie's not feeling better. But just we think, you know, no matter how you like to drink our bourbon or our rye, we support it. Doesn't matter. We just want you to enjoy it, and we want you to immerse yourselves in our stories and our liquid. Come visit us at filmlandspirits.com. And if you follow us on Instagram, we'll keep you up to date on as we move into new states, and we're available in back bars and retail stores for you there.
Troy said it all. So I will just add, Sean, thank you for your service and Semper Fi.
Alrighty, folks, be sure to push your stool in. This has been a Second Front podcast presentation, found on Apple, Spotify, and wherever podcasts can be found.